You gotta go get something to eat, man. I'm hungry in the motherfucker.
Hey, yo, man. Damn, what's taking home so long, son?
Freaking calm down, man. You coming?
Many men wish death upon me. Blood in my eye, dog, and I can't see. I'm trying to be what I'm destined to be. And niggas trying to take my life away. I put a hole in a nigga for fucking with me. My back on the wall, now you gon' see. Better watch how you talk when you talk about me. Cause I'll come and take your life away. Many men, many, 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 many men wish death on me, Lord. I don't cry no more. Don't look to the sky no more.
So what's your name?
TJ, a.k.a. Money Man Stacks.
Where you from?
California. North Richmond, California at that.
So you got tattoos?
Yeah, I got a few tattoos, man. I had to put my city on my hand, though, man. I love my city.
Let me see.
Rich city, man. I love my city. I love music, so... This is what 31 years of my life I've been. So I figure, you feel me? All my tattoos mean something anyway. I got a story for all of them. But this, Rich City, man, it's just where I'm from. 31 years of my life, I love my city. I wouldn't change it for nothing.
You got me, I got you. You got me, I got you. Rich City, I'll never let you go. You don't know that I love you, Rich. You don't know that I love you, Rich. Rich City, baby.
Richmond, see, I adapted to surviving, really. So, I mean, I really wouldn't want to be nowhere else because I'm immune to it. But I done been to other places, you know, like out of state, Tuscaloosa, Alabama. I done been to places, it ain't too much different than out here, you feel me? Everybody the same. It's just how you carry yourself when you go other places. But me, I feel like this, man. You live by the gun, you die by the gun, you feel me? It ain't even that serious. Everybody out here ain't with killing somebody. Everybody really have a purpose and got goals and want to actually accomplish something. So, with that being said, man, just Richmond, period. I'm so lost in words. There's so much stuff I can say about Richmond, you feel me? I got to change, like, I mean, music-wise, you feel? Everybody, we can be like Young Money or something. Everybody can come together and get some money. That's how I feel as far as in the music in Richmond. But there's so much gangbanging going on, don't nobody want to put their pride to the side. It's a bigger picture than just killing somebody or getting your name known in the streets. It's a bigger picture than that. You can get your name known in the streets as a rapper. You can get your name known in the streets as a producer, a cameraman, a lawn man, whatever, a recycle man, whatever. You can get your name put in the street by a lot of things. It ain't always got to be violence. When people grow up to feel like that's how they got to make a name for themselves. Me personally, I did a lot of stuff at my younger age and I changed. So me making a name for myself, they ain't gonna never say, oh, he was a bad dude, he was in the street, he was doing this, he was doing that. Nope, not me. I was one of them kids, man, that came up with, I hang with a lot of people, did a lot of things, but I ain't did nothing strange, you feel me? I mean, I'm just one of them cool cats, man, trying to survive. I got two kids I gotta live for, cause a lot of things happening. I just lost a little homie, you feel me? I got a partner that just lost his little kid out in the O, and another little kid just got shot in the O. So, man, it's like Richmond, California. Man, this is a tough place to survive in, but I'm surviving, so I'm blessed. I mean, you know, a lot of people gotta do what they gotta do to survive and get by. But killing somebody, that's a whole nother something else. I lost my father to a victim of violence. He was a little dude like me, and he was in the house with somebody else, feel me? And I guess the dude, he ordered me $5. My pops, you feel me? He was a user, you feel me? And he served me. He gave him his $5, but he went in his room, you feel me? And be like, do what he do to get high. Dude came in there, felt like he was just, you know, like, okay, here's your money, go in his room. Dude wasn't feeling that. So he had to go in there and take my dude, you know, take my daddy what he was trying to do. And my daddy, you know, like me, man, you a little dude, you ain't just gonna let nobody push up on you. So, you feel me? He just tried to take what he was trying, you feel me? He was just protecting what was trying to be taken from him. That's all, basically. The dude stabbed my daddy over 100 times. Anyway, every way possible. all over his body. It ain't a part of his body he didn't have a stab wound in. And then he wrapped him up. Well, matter of fact, he left him in the house for 2 days, wrapped him up, and then threw him behind North Richmond. You feel me? On the street, man. And I'm riding around looking for my daddy, trying to figure out what's going on, getting a call, man. I mean, you know, 31 years, man. And then something like that happened to your father.
This was recently?
Yeah, that was recently. I mean, it's been probably a year now. Probably not even that long, you feel me? But, man, I mean, I'm a man, though. I got 2 kids to live for, so a lot of pain I go through, man, I got to just deal with it.
Looking out of my project window, oh, I be unexpired. Looking out of my
what's your name?
BOA the K, man. Formerly Ann Banks. Everybody knows me as Ann Banks.
So, what's your profession?
I do music. I'm a producer / artist, engineer. I do it all.
Have you ever indulged in selling drugs or anything like that?
I mean, I did everything I had to do just to survive. Shit, you gotta think about it. What y'all say? Don't have to coming up where we're coming from, in the city of Richmond. Just it's so much bad, so much mamas, aunties, cousins on dope, don't know which way to turn to. Everybody doing drugs. They ain't doing drugs, they doing something that can cause them to go to jail. Now they gone from the family. Now the youngsters gotta somehow survive. The granny. Your auntie ain't really got it, but they struggling to try to help you out. You go outside, you see your partners. Cassie's going through the same thing you're going through. You know, you go to their house, it's just as worse as at your house. Ain't no food in the refrigerator.
So that's how the bonds are normally made, like on the street corner, people turn to their friends?
Of course. You bond off of what you go through. How they say misery loves company. It's true. If we going through something, we might as well go through it together. Because, you know, we going to figure it out together. We going to figure out how to come up out this hole together and start putting some food on the table and start putting some faces out here that's hungry. That little cat over there walking and holding his shoes. Find him a pair of shoes. Get him some. We know him. He come up with us. He hang around us. We know his mama. We know his brother now. You get out there, you get to hustling. And then when you get to hustling, you feel life coming back at you, even though it may be wrong. You feel it giving itself back to you for all what you went through. Money get to still accumulating while, you know, you're looking back and people got jobs and looking at you like you're doing something wrong, but, you know, they didn't walk in the shoes you had to walk in.
African Americans were once empowered. Drugs were placed in our communities to take away our strength. Dated back as early as the 50s, African Americans, Blacks, Negroes, how we came together and marched for Emmett Till, how we boycotted buses for Rosa Parks, how we fought for equality, Plessy versus Ferguson. Empowered and focused we were. In the 60s, how we joined together with mixed races all across the country for freedom rides, how we marched for the Civil Rights Act, how we fought for voting rights, from the assassination of Kennedy, Malcolm, and MLK. And in the 70s, people used drugs as an outlet from the violence and hatred surrounding pivotal issues like the Civil War and the Vietnam War. Drugs such as marijuana and LSD spread quickly because people viewed drugs at that time as a social change, a means from escaping the harsh realities of racism and inequality. And in the 80s, drug abuse was our nation's number one issue. Crack cocaine had arrived and dominated our Black communities. Most would say Blacks were targeted. Once so empowered and focused, now so broken down and hopeless. Blacks were on crack, selling crack, and going to jail for crack. And spilling over into the 90s, crack cocaine had destroyed the Black family, leaving the mothers strung out on crack cocaine, the father strung out or either in jail, and the Black child was left to fend for themselves, to raise siblings, and to survive. And today, Most say survival is all they know. No.
Why the crack have to hit so hard, even though it's almost over? Why niggas can't get no jobs? Why they come up with the witness protection? Why they let the Terminator win the election? Come on, pay attention. Why sell in the stores what you can sell in the streets? Why say the hottest shit,
the police say that the reason that crime is so high and murders haven't been solved is on the part of the community, lack of cooperation.
You say lack of cooperation, but the community don't got to get up every day and get a paycheck for what they call themselves doing. If you went to school for this or went to the academy to be an officer, you was trained. And if they're not training you right, then you should get better trained on how to perform your investigation duties. You can't rely on the people of the streets and put it on them when you're not giving them the right to protect themselves like you can. You can ride around with your badge. You can ride around with your gun. You can give a criminal a second chance, a second thought to think about something for doing something while you around. But when you ain't around, I got to sit here and deal with this criminal or this so-called person that's doing something that's against the law in life with a gun or with a weapon. And you expect for me to watch this and notice this and put my life and family in danger because they're not scared of me. They're scared of going to jail.
Right.
You want me to put them in danger to help you? You want to make laws to say if we don't help you, you can convict us. Why? What officer you know gonna do that job without getting a paycheck and going right and risking his life and taking it home to his wife and his family? If they cut your check enough, you have a lot of officers quitting.
When I met Bessie and her four boys, Thomas was four, and Wayne and Bobby, and I told her, I said, no, once we get this started, it's no quitting, we're gonna go all the way through. I said, I'm not gonna be like most fathers, abandoning the kids and stuff like that. I said, once we get started with this, we're gonna go all the way through it. She said, okay, so I helped her raise them.
Mm-hmm.
My orders was back then was, you know, y'all keep y'all going clean, stay in school and take care of yourself, you know, and we did a good job. Thomas was a good kid, and I had no complaints, you know, just situation happened because the fact that I was helped raising the child, you know what I'm saying? And I didn't look at it as his son, I looked at it as my son, it was my job. I'm out here working, taking care of the kids, stuff like that. So, you know, if they came by and wanted to spend time with their kids, stuff like that, I had no problem with that. I had passion for that because at times I need help. Especially when they got a little bit older, you know, it was kind of hard for me, you know, to really raise him when he's 18, 19 years old. And I have to talk to the father, you know, because there's a certain line a stepfather can't cross over, especially when a child gets a certain age, you know, especially if their father's living, you want to be able to talk to them. Talk to him or her and let you know this area I can't touch. I need you to come on in and help me out in this. You know what I'm saying? Because we want our kids to grow up being doing the good things in life, not just getting shot or getting killed or, you know, going to jail and stuff like that. Because it's enough for them in prison as it is.
How did the authorities notify you that this happened to your son?
No, the authorities, my son,
Dwayne. What was your first reaction back the day? Yep, son.
My son called me, but he told me that my son got shot. I thought he got shot in a leg or something like that. And I didn't come to my mind. Death didn't come to my mind or that like that. I said, because that people they could have told me. Mm-hmm. They didn't tell me that my son got killed. He just told me that Mama Thomas got shot. So my reaction is that, you know, I went next door and told my neighbor and everything else, and you know, I went down there. I went down there and I seen all of these people and stuff down there. And then when I seen that and I seen the yellow rope, and I said, Lord, I know that this is not my son. And the only way that I knew that that was my son is by his tennis shoes. By his tennis shoes, and I came over to the crowd and I seen my son out there with the, you know, with the bullet holes off, and you know, it was just like, you know, it took the breath out of me. It knocked me to my knees. And it took the breath out of me. It just like my whole mind just went blank. When I came over there, I just seen all these ropes, yellow ropes and stuff. But when I got halfway over that overpass, the only thing I could say, I know this not none of my son.
Modesto, California. Christmas Eve, 2002. Just after 5 p.m., Lacey Peterson's mother, Sharon Rocha, got a disturbing call from her son-in-law, Scott. Lacey, he told her, was missing. As Scott would later tell police, he had last seen Lacey at 9:30 that morning when he left home to go fishing in the San Francisco Bay. But when he returned, his wife was gone. Scott also told Sharon that Lacey had planned to walk their dog that morning in nearby East La Loma Park.
This is where Lacey Peterson supposedly walked her dog on Christmas Eve. From the moment she disappeared, this park became central location for the search for Lacey Peterson. In fact, family, friends, neighbors, the community was all fanned out here. Every inch of this park was searched by Modesto police. They never found one shred of evidence that she was here.
The facts surrounding the story made it so much more poignant. It was Christmas time. She was just about to give birth. The delivery of her son, her unborn son Connor, was imminent. Connor would be her first child, a baby boy, and she and her family, I guess, were living out the happiest time of their life when she went missing. People were cheering. It was as if Lacey were everybody's sister.
My sister, my strength and my pride. Only God may know why. Still I will get by.
They came by and shot. But prior to that, my man came by and picked my grandson up. He was in the car with her. He wanted to go with me, so I let him go with me. We went to the post office. On the way back to the post office, I got a call that it happened. And then the city she lived in, and it was such a tragic death because she was pregnant. And the city, the police ain't doing nothing about it, nothing.
She was pregnant?
Yeah, she's 8 months pregnant.
So what is your outlook on the violence in Richmond?
It's terrible. The police care more about catching drug dealers and spending millions of dollars on that. And murder's supposed to be the number one crime, but y'all ain't doing the number one thing to do nothing about it. The city of Richmond told us to take down a memorial because it would make somebody run. They said their only excuse was it would make somebody wreck something by going around that curb right there.
By looking?
Yeah.
And they have billboards?
Yeah.
That people drive by and see?
So they just let you know what we're dealing with when it comes to the police. They don't care. My feelings go out. Every parent, every brother, sister that lose somebody now since my daughter, because I know how it feels. It's a hurt feeling that I wouldn't pass on to my worst in it. That's a messed up feeling that you never forget. Mm-hmm. I think about my daughter every day. So, so young, so vibrant, and now she gone. And I think it's a shame that she outlived her. She supposed to outlive me.
I got over here, the whole street was like blocked up. That's how I found out.
So how have you been dealing with that, like being a, are you her older brother or younger brother?
Yeah, it's my brother. I deal with it every day because I got to come right here every day and be in front of here where it happened. So I deal with it every day. I think about, it's not a day that I go by that I don't think about it.
I'm Latoya Thomas. She's my little sister.
Oh, so your little sister. So was she the baby?
She was the second to me.
How are you? I know I keep asking the same question, but I just want other people to know how you guys are dealing and coping with this since that tragic day.
It's hard. I mean, we got to stick together. Since that day, like, all we do is see each other every day, trying to make sure our kids are all right, you know? As long as we stick together, ain't nothing we can not do for her and her children, so.
Can we give us, like, a little background about her so people could know what type of person she was?
She was a bubbly person, always singing, you know? She was very homely, always at the house. She was always the one that told you how to, like, handle everything, you know? She was more nurturing because she had children first, so out of all of us, she had her children first, so she had the more motherly, you know, information for all of us, you know what I'm saying? She always was the babysitter. Before she even had her kids, she would always have other people's kids. She was always, like, nurturing that back, you know?
Well, this whole situation that occurred that day was so not her. This was something just happened randomly.
She was about to get ready for my nephew's birthday party. She was on her way to pick up my niece from school. I got the call. I was on my way to work. And one of my cousins told me about it. I didn't even know what was going on. And when I got here, the police told me she was airlifted to John Muir. And I ran into moms right here. And they told us we couldn't even get through right here. So they told us she was in John Muir. But we watching the news. And we could tell her she's still right here. So the police just lied to us all the way around, told us that she was way in Oakland. And so we had to hop fences just to get right here to where the spot was. And we didn't know where her body was or nothing. They told us way over there around the corner that she was at John Muir, right? So they just flat out lied to us and just told us some nonsense that it made no sense. And once we got here, you know, she still... It just happened, so they could have had all opportunity to save her baby. If they couldn't save her, you know, the first thing I said when I jumped over the fence in the crime scene was, why y'all didn't take the baby out? And they drew guns on me, so, I mean, it's a difficult situation to kind of deal with. And it took forever for the coroner to come out. It was kind of rough, you know, with her body and stuff. And it didn't make no sense. It was kind of
like she was saying, the Lacey Peterson case is it's similar because they were both with child. But this was more malicious to me than the Lacey Peterson story because it was some type of crime of passion done by her husband. But this is done by a complete stranger that doesn't know your sister.
Please does not try to contact this
party. I called them. They don't call.
For the niggas that's out there shooting the girls and the sisters and the mamas out there, man. Baby. Just swinging that weapon. When you go back to your pocket blowing your blunt really laughing, the inside nigga, you really hurt, nigga. You hurt. You gotta be. For you to ever think it's real, nigga, to take a female life, nigga, that ain't slanging nothing at you. That's only here to create life. And that's how you got here, a woman.
Mm-hmm.
So when you slanging your weapon, nigga, and wanna say, yeah, I got that, nigga, she shouldn't have been right there, because I know your talk. Instead of really keeping it real like I fucked up, you telling your nigga that bitch shouldn't have been right there. Ain't you? I know you is. You doing that. That's what niggas do. Nigga, keep it real, cuz. Stop doing that shit. If you know who in that shit, you stopping little niggas from being stars, nigga, out here, blood.
Mm-hmm.
Nigga, these niggas in the East Coast, nigga, eating.
Mm-hmm.
Got all kind of wars going on, but they know how to respect it and eat. Niggas is out here, nigga, we got talent. Niggas know how to do music from all levels. We can all have money. These niggas over here want to funk it out.
Love you. Miss you.
It's been too long and I'm lost without you. What am I gonna do? Said I've been needing you.
So needing you.
Maybe I'm saying who's been with you.
Is your heart still mine?
I wanna cry sometime. I miss you.
Off to college. Yes, you went away. Straight from high school. You up and left me. We were close friends. Awesome lovers, did everything for one another. Now you're gone and I'm lost without you here now. But I know I gotta live and make it somehow.
How many shootings have you known to be at so many schools out here in Richmond?
You know stuff will happen. They had a Caliban shooting one time, and they fixed that. And that was at Caliban. Whenever it happens in their schools or around too many of their kids, they don't want to segregate us. They don't want to make us have to split ourselves apart. And I have not a racial bone in my body. But the truth is what the truth is. Let you go out to one of the cities where they're not having no crime and something goes wrong, I guarantee something is going to be a change immediately. They're going to do all they can. Let an officer get killed, shot, even battered. They're going to put so much force on that to find the person that did it. But let a young man that he don't know, especially not his race, keep constantly going up and find him on the street dead. 30 holes in him, 10 holes in him. It becomes now, it's just a bad city out there. We need the people help. Mm-hmm. You didn't need the people help when the officer got shot. You went hunting him down, found him. You didn't need the people help for none of these kind of things right here when it becomes them.
If this type of violence was occurring in the city of Orinda, would you as a resident tolerate this madness?
No, would not.
Would you speak against it? Would your community be in outrage?
Yes, definitely. Should be, at least, yeah.
Okay, one last question. If someone in your family was killed, would you expect for the police department to at least call and give you a follow-up on things?
Yeah.
So are you an Orinda resident? And if the youth in your neighborhoods, your community was getting killed at a high capacity, like the youth in the city of Richmond was getting killed, you as a resident, would this be acceptable?
Absolutely not.
Okay, and if someone in your family was killed by violence, would you expect feedback from the police department?
Immediately, yes, of course.
Would you expect for them to follow up,
Definitely,
even if... Okay, and if you would and still no feedback, would that be acceptable? Why isn't any violence occurring in Orinda?
I mean, that's not what is meant to be there, you know? There's factors, a lot of factors that can make, that take part in why the violence is happening in Richmond. And I was just asked a question by you, and you told me that, you know, the African-American community or predominantly African-American where the violence is happening.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, a person, a man is the religion of his companion, you know? So if you have some heedless, self-worshipping, materialistic, devil, gangster, some drantran on your, you know, in your ear, on your radio, in your mind, you know, if you're with them, you're going to be, you know, of their religion, of their way. So if you're going to have, you know, someone portraying or you know, making it seem like, you know, money rules everything around me, all that type of stuff, all that gangster stuff, then this is going to be how you're moving, how you're walking, you know. That might have, you know, the music, I would think music's very influential, you know. Even overseas, I've been to countries where the children can run around barefoot, thousands of people can gather, and there won't even be an argument taking place, you know? But even, you know, Tupac's name will be spray painted on the wall in countries overseas, or they don't even speak English, you know? Or, you know, so music is very influential. And I can't, you know, I know it's increased, the violence has increased, and, you know?
I'm more than frustrated, I'm flustered. I'm so sick of the violence that goes on in Richmond. I'm pissed off about it. I'm angry, I'm mad. Sometimes I just wanna walk down the street and just start slapping people because I feel as though I can get away with it. Everybody else does. Dudes get shot, the police don't know who it is, nobody wants to talk, nobody wanna tell, I'm not snitching, I'm not no snitch, that's not even where we from, no, we don't even like him, I didn't even know him like that. As soon as the funeral come, everybody on Facebook posting pictures talking about the rest in peace. This is a throwback picture. Oh, I missed him. He was my best friend. You didn't even know him. But know this, that I'm pissed.
On a whole different note,
The police infiltrated our hoods from North Richmond to the South Side, and they took anybody that had any influence over these youngsters to the federal penitentiary by bringing money out here and paying people to wear wires and snitch on the people that had influence over our community.
That's what
happened. Once those people left, they left our kids, our youngsters out here misguided and corrupt.
Hey, hey, hey!
That's what happened.
You hit that one.
Police did this, and they know what they're doing. Every time a nigga get knocked down or put up out of here, they bring another race in here. They trying to weed us out. It's like Operation Target Niggas. Straight up. Wow. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, this don't only work for my hood, but it's going to work for everybody's hood. Stay in your hood. Don't leave your hood. Guard your hood. Protect your hood. Every entrance and every exit until this is ceased. Until we can stop people from coming in here and infiltrating our hood, we ain't gonna have our hood back. That's including the police and these snitches and these motherfuckers that wanna put bullshit on Facebook and all that. That's ratting. All that shit is a way of telling shit. Letting motherfuckers infiltrate and come in here and do what they wanna do. Because the police came in and took all our power away from us. The majority of our power and people that would influence our youngsters into doing other things and having money. Everybody broke right now because the police taking everything from them. They ain't giving them no jobs. This is a real, real depression in our hood. We having burglaries out here. People ain't being able to get money in a hustling way. They starting to take from our community, and it's not right. And the police see it. And they're not telling
you
about
jail,
it. Why? Because they want to use all this as a weapon to infiltrate our hood and do what they've been doing to us behind closed doors for a long time. That's all I got to say. Everybody know.
I came to the aid of people. Cherry Street. You know, I've seen people die right here.
I got killed on Woodward. Second in Ohio, Butter. Yep.
On the South Side.
Yep. Yep. My cousin got killed right down there on our Third Silver.
Second in Woodward.
And so all these cases are still open. No
walking
one has been.
This year. Walking home. This year.
It ain't like it's 48 hours around here.
But the thing is, hey,
ain't never 48 hours around here.
This song's dedicated to my homies in that gangsta league. Why'd you have to go so soon? It seems like yesterday we were hanging round the hood. Now I'm gonna keep your memory alive like a homie should. A lifetime of memory going down the drain. I like to keep stepping, but I can't get past the pain.
I took my 40 to your memory. Take a drink and I start to think, and I know one day soon we'll be hanging out.
This is for my homies, well, well.
See you when I get there.
In that gangsta lane, that gangsta lane.
This is for my homies.
This is for my homies, well.
See you when I get there.
In that gangsta lane, that gangsta lane.
On the message from me. Ha! Tell him put down those dice for a second, Lord. Listen to his homie. Could you tell him I'll never let go of his memory, so his son will know. Ha! You don't have to cry no more, 'cause God's got his back. I said God's got his back.
Going down the drain.
Going down the drain.
I like to
fate, and I no wonder soon we'll be hanging out.
This is for my homies.
This is for my.
Dedicated to my homies in that gangsta league. Tommy from Master's Touch, my boy YB, and my boy Emir. And whoever else out there got a homie that's in that gangsta league. And also my boys in the pen, and they'll never see the street again. Cause you know what? It don't matter what they was doing while they was here. They could've been banging, slanging, but they ain't here no more. Now somebody's daddy, somebody's baby, that's somebody's homie. So go and let them rest in peace while they in that gangsta lean. You know what I'm saying? That's on the real low.
This is for my homie.